Okay, that was very helpful. Thank you, really. And share screen. Yes, let us record the lecture. Some of you guys may listen or watch it one more time, or some of you guys who are not attending the courses can follow at any time they wish. This is the good part of the online courses, right? Okay, so modeling mechanical systems. When I make this so small, okay, I'll switch this here, and I'll make it large. If I can, yes, I can. And then with this, I've got a really big screen. Okay, whatever. Where is the room? It is here, it is. Pen. Yes, so mechanical things, mechanical systems. And we studied mechanical systems under two main topics. One of them was translational motion, right? Where the motion is just linear, okay? No rotation involved. And the subtopic was rotational motion, okay? Motion. And when we dealing with translational motion, right, we had some mechanical impedances, which were the mass, friction, and spring. So mass, when we try to move some object linearly, that object resists to the force applied with its motion, friction, and elasticity. And this is a motion to do with the acceleration, A, or the first derivative of speed or velocity. Viscous friction was to do with the derivative of displacement, right? To do with, so reduces or impedes the speed of the object, and K is to do with the displacement, as you remember. And we are applying a force and getting either displacement or something related to displacement over time is speed, and we are getting speed. Yes. Any question or no? Okay, now in rotational systems, right? In rotational mechanical systems, we have the same concept of impedance. Now, instead of taking the mass, again, it is something to do with mass. We call it inertia, moment of inertia. And for the same term, actually, but with a different letter, friction, but rotational friction, and the spring constant, but now it is something to do with torsional spring. So the other one was just linear spring, and this is rotational or torsional spring. Again, now instead of working with force, what was the rotational effect of force? torque, either with tau or, as our book uses, as our textbook uses, T for torque. And instead of x, which was displacement, now we are talking about angular displacement. And if we are measuring the speed at the output, which is now angular speed, and denoted with omega. So now the unit is here, radian, omega is radian per second. But in the real world, nobody is using this unit, radian per second. They rather use sometimes hertz, okay, 1/s, but most of the time RPM, which is revolution or rotation per minute. Good. So this was the recapture of last week. I remember where we just stopped the lecture last week. Now, when we work with rotational mechanical systems, okay, at the output of the motor, we get a rotation, but this rotation, okay, interesting, how can I go? We can discover. This motion, obviously, suppose that this is your motor, okay, and the motor. I'll come back to this motor, the concept of motor, produces, it has a output shaft, okay? You just feed it, okay, with electric energy, okay? Suppose that with some voltage you are applying, okay? Suppose that it's a DC motor, and it produces a rotation, right? This rotation is either measured with theta, which is either radian, or sometimes, as the French people like, tour or rotation, amount of rotation in maybe degrees, okay? Or you can measure it, as I said, with omega, radian per second, or RPM, mostly RPM. Okay, but you have to be consistent about the units. Now, this motion, obviously, at the end of the motor, you obtain a speed and also torque. In fact, they are inversely proportional to each other, right? And when you multiply these two physical variables, you get the power of the motor anyway. But what I want to say is, if the power is constant, because it's like this, if this is constant, by decreasing the speed, you can increase the torque, or the other way around, you can increase speed and reduce the torque. When do you need this? Well, I guess we are all either use cars, those bikes, okay? When we are climbing a hill, we need torque, you know? We need torque. We don't need speed, so we can reduce the speed to increase the torque. Or if you are going just, you know, in a on a level road, let's say, straight road, we don't need that much torque, so we can increase the speed using making use of the same power. So let us see. I just found a couple of nice pictures from the internet this morning, in fact. Look at this. course. Meshing gears. Oops. Meshing gears. What is meshing gear? Gear couples, let's say. When we, actually not when, this is almost all the time, apart from those very simple applications, all motors have a gearbox just at the output of the motor. Gearbox, or in the cars as well, gearbox are, you know, full of, or train of, a series of gears. You just, by using that, you know, gear lever, you are changing the gears, right? But concentrate on, at each instant, you are using a meshed couple, a meshed pair of gears. One of those gears are called the input or drive gear. So the motor is, in fact, giving the rotation from this side. Look at this nice animation. And this is the driven or output gear, gear one, gear two. And you are introducing your input torque, and you can measure the rotation, angle of rotation at the input. Suppose that there is no loss, no friction, no backlash, nothing. We can talk about those concepts later on. Suppose that they are well, you know, coupled, quite tight, they are well aligned, whatever, you know. So no loss in power, which is quite unreal, but assume that they are dealing with, at the moment, for the moment, lossless gears, okay? And the parameter of input gear has this one. So N1 is number of okay, let us, yes, I want to scribble something here. Suppose that N1 is, N is number of teeth, okay? Each these, you know, parts are called teeth, number of teeth. R is radius of gears, what else? Torque and T1, theta 1 is the rotation. And at the output, you get the output torque, okay, you are transferring, and rotation at the output by means of the second or driven gear, which has N2 number of teeth, and R2 is the radius. So, when they rotate, can we, let me formulate it. Let me change color, okay? And we are going to, we are using two main principles. I'll make use of these, you know, physical principles, but you would even write by means of your experiences. The distance traveled at each circumference of gear, okay, is the same. And the second principle is the power you, or the energy you introduce, is the same as the energy you get out. But what is the distance traveled at each circle? What was the, how do we compute the circumference of a simple circle? The arc, which is the whole arc, 360 degrees, in other words, 2 pi times r. Wasn't it? The circumference was 2 pi, which is the arc you traveled on, and radius. Okay, now suppose that this arc is in the input just at the radian of theta 1 times r1 gives us because they travel at each distance, theta 2 r2. So the relationship between the output displacement to input displacement is in fact r1 over r2. Okay. To be honest, in the in the industry, in the real world, we mostly use number of tools instead of using radius. As you know, radius and number of tools are directly proportional. So instead of using R1, you can just use N1 over N2. I can prove this relationship, but no need for that. So this is the first relationship between the two gears, which are meshed or coupled. And the second relationship will be expressed in terms of torque. And as I said, the input energy is the output energy if there is no loss. How do we measure energy? How do we state energy? Energy is, well, if it is work in linear motion, force times displacement gives us work or energy, right? But since here rotation is the concern, main concern, instead of force, we are using torque, okay? Torque times displacement, okay, gives us a kind of a measure of energy we are introducing. And at the output, we are getting T2 times theta 2. Okay, so we can write another relationship, theta 2 over theta 1 is what? T1, okay, over T2. T1 over T2. This can be also written as N1 over N2, you know, using the equation we just obtained. But as I said, you know, we are living in a real world. We don't have to be that much mathematical, right? We can't close our eyes and think. We know that if they are meshed and if they are rotating, which one rotates fast? The small one rotates fast and gets more distance. So look at here. This is a small N1. One is smaller than two. N1 and displacement, they are inversely proportional, right? And as you know, we get more torque from a large radius. You know, gears with large radii produce more torque. So look at here. If they are big, they give large torque. So I'm sure when you you know, after this lecture, you just revise these concepts on your own. So simple, they are so simple. Look at here now. Here it is. Since I like to work with transfer functions with boxes, theta 2 over theta 1 is n1 over n2, or t2 over t1 is t2 over t1 is n2 over n1, right? The same concepts. Here I added another relationship, which is useful. I don't know why our book didn't include this expression. Displacement and speed, they are just proportional to each other. So since we have this theta 1 over theta 2 is n2 over n1, which is related to the speed as well. Look at here, the smaller gear rotates faster. Okay, the big or larger gear, bigger gear rotates slower. As I said, they are not difficult. Now let us make use of these concepts in our analysis. Okay, look at here. So it looks like complicated, but not. This is the drive gear. We are introducing some torque by means of a motor here and getting output. But at the output, of course, there is a load. Okay, we are rotating something. We are rotating, I don't know, the conveyor band. We are rotating some come for elevator, I don't know. So there is a load at the output, and this load has an inertia, has a friction, has a torsion, and they are represented with J, D, K. Now, this version doesn't have draw, unfortunately. I have to renew this version. Anyway, let us do this. In the second hour, I'll get the PDF version so that I can scribble on the presentation files, presentation slides. Now look at here. What was the principle? Even in electrical systems, sum of sum of impedances, right? Impedances times, you remember from electrical, times currents, loop currents. Okay, loop currents gives us the voltages applied. Or, in fact, I didn't give this, but sum of admittances, which is just the reciprocal of impedance, times the node voltages gives us I. Okay, we didn't use, but you know this from the circuit theory. But in mechanical things, in mechanical systems, sum of mechanical impedances, again, impedances, times displacement, either x, okay, or theta, equals the force applied or the torque applied. Okay, forget about this because we are done with the translational systems. So sum of impedances times displacement gives us torque. We know this. Now let us write an equation of motion for this system. Don't see this. Just write this part because we will transfer the effect of load, impedances of load to the input side. Now, sum of impedances, J, S squared, because J is something to do with the acceleration, plus DS. Okay. J S square plus D S plus K, all right, times the displacement, which is theta 2, right? We are here, theta 2, equals the torque T 2, their function of S, okay. But suppose that we want to reflect all the things to the input parts. So J S square plus D S plus K. How can I write theta 2 in terms of theta 1? Okay. The relationship between thetas and the number of numbers of t's is this. So for theta 2, theta 1 times, okay, theta 1 times m1 over m2, right? M1 over m2 equals t2. I want to, how can I get rid of how can I write T2 in terms of T1? T1. T2 is T1 times N2 over M1. N2 over M1. I'm writing everything from here. You know, we just wrote together. So let us put this in this format, right? Okay, I mean in this format rather, sum of impedances. Now look at here, J, M1 over N2, another M1 over N2 is coming, J, N1 over N2 square, S square, okay? S square, so I'll make this. Plus D N1 over N2 square S plus K, okay, N1 over N2 square, okay, excuse me, square, okay, times theta 1 of S, okay, I'll make this look nicer, okay, theta 1 of S equals what? T1 of S. Now we are theta 1 and T1, we are all in the input part. Here it is, okay. Now instead of you know, spending so much time because we will keep reflecting the impedances from one end to the other depending on the transfer function you are required to obtain. Okay, we will keep transferring impedances from one end to the other, from either input to the output or from output to the input. So instead of using and obtaining this for each example or application, let us generalize this. The load can be thought of as having been reflected from output to the input. Generalizing the results, we can make the following statement. Rotational mechanical impedances, okay, I'll change color again. rotational mechanical impedances J, D, and K, okay, can be reflected through gear trains by multiplying the mechanical impedance by the ratio number of teeth of gear on destination shaft over number of teeth of gear on source shaft square. And one is number of teeth of gear on destination shaft. What is destination? What is source? Destination is the place that we want to go, we aim to go, okay? And source is we are moving from. Source is where we are moving from. So we are moving from the where is this slide? We are moving from right to the left because the input is on the left. The input, so the concept is when you go this way, obviously, N1 over N2 square will come as a factor to each impedance. So number of teeth of gear on destination shaft divided by number of teeth of gear on source shaft square. Well, I rather use this instead of obtaining for each example, you know, this relationship. It is not difficult. You will know it by heart. Let us use it in this example. Okay, in this example. Okay. Look at here, for example. What is the question? Obtain the transfer function of theta 2 of S over T1 of S. Okay. This is the system. This is the complicated system. But in the end, we want to make it like this. An equivalent J, okay, and I can draw something like this, or you can do this, do like this as well. It's up to you, really. Okay, I'm not a mechanical guy in the end, anyway. So this is equivalent J, this is equivalent K, this is equivalent DE. In the end, we wanna write, okay, output over input. Transfer functions are output over input. So where is the destination? Where is the destination? Destination is the output. So we want to write an equation, you know, relating theta to but T1. So we will here write some equivalent torque impression. So in the end, we will write this J E S square plus D E S plus K E, okay, times theta 2 of S equals the torque here. Let us use the same in this, right? Theta 2 of S. But the book asks this. Never mind, we will do. Now let us obtain JE, the equivalent J. Equivalent J. Where is destination? Look at this statement. Number of teeth of gear on destination shaft. So destination over source square. Where is destination? Destination left side or right side? Left hand side or right hand side? We don't know. We need to check. I realize a question. Right. Why right? You are right. Because you said right. Theta 2, because that's what the problem states, okay? You're right. So in this part, We have a J already, so write J, okay, J2, plus reflect J1 to this side. J1 times how can we reflect it? Destination, the number of teeth in destination part, N2 over N1 square. That's it. Now we are, we have an equivalent inertia on the right hand side in the where we will get the output from. Okay, so we can write DE, okay, in the same fashion. So DE is going to be, if you are correct in here, you can write directly D2 plus D1, D1 N2 over N1 square. And how about K equivalent? We have a K2 here, okay. But there is no K to reflect, okay? There is no spring constant to be reflected. So the problem is solved actually. We know JE, we know DE, we know KE. Theta 2 is what is required. We don't want this T2. So we need to write, we need to remember T1 of S over T2 of S in terms of numbers of teeth. What was the relation? What was the relationship? The small gear produces small torque. So M N1 N2. Okay. So let us write the result. JE S square plus DE S plus KE, which is just K2 anyway, okay, times theta 2 of S equals getter of T2, right, N2 over M1, okay, N2 over N1 times T1. T1 of S, okay. That's it. This is the transfer function. Let me write in this form then. Theta 2 of S over T1 of S will be N2 over N1 divided by JE S square plus D E S plus K E. That's it. I've got the transfer function. If I know the transfer function, I can see the displacement with respect to the torque input I introduced. This is the answer. Okay, N over M1. Okay, now let us look at here. Another nice animation. Here it is. Suppose that you want to have a big gear ratio. Okay, this N1 over N2 or N2 over N1 is called gear ratio. Gear ratio. Suppose that you want to obtain a gear ratio of, I don't know, 100. So in order to achieve this big or large gear ratio, you need to use a very small gear, okay? And the big gear, 100 times larger compared to the small one. Which is not practical. Which is not practical, because you can not even find a kind of box or container for that. So instead, we can achieve this big ratio, big gear ratio, with some factors using gear trains. Okay. So what was the answer? What was the question? having 100. So 100 can be achieved two times I don't know, two times 25, for example. So instead of two times 50, you can get, you know, you can obtain through seriously connected gears. Now, let me ask you the question. There are here three gears. Okay, and they are called A, B, C. A has 20 teeth, B has 60 teeth, and C has 10 teeth. Okay, and suppose that, as seen actually, the first gear A, rotates, look at here, clockwise. The one in the middle, anti-clockwise or counterclockwise. And the one at C in the end, and again the same as A, clockwise. And suppose that the first one A rotates with 60 RPM. What would be the speed in C? High school problem, if not earlier. Any guess? What was the relationship between the omega 1, omega 2, and n? N1, N2, or N2, N1? Are they directly proportional or inversely proportional? Which one rotates faster, the smallest one or largest one? They are inversely proportional. Yes, the small one, you know, rotates more and faster. So N2 over N1, right? N2 over N1. So look at here. Come back to this system. It has 20 tooth, 60 tooth. So the gear ratio is 20 to 60 is 1/3. So the speed will be reduced or increased? Will be reduced. 60, and A rotates at 60 RPM, right? B will rotate at 1/3 of it. 60 over 3 is just 20 RPM. And another coupled gear here, and the gear ratio is 60 to 10, 6 to 1. So the speed will be increased 6 times. So at C, 6 times 20 makes 120 RPM, right? Okay, so this is it. This is an example, a nice example I found this morning, in fact. Look at here. Suppose that you want to get a big gear ratio, but look at here. In order to eliminate gears with large red eye is it may look strange to you. It is a kind of Latin words have different ways of making plural. So this is the plural of radius. Okay, you cannot just put an S radiuses. So red eye is the plural of radius. So eliminate, in order to eliminate gears with large red eye, a gear train is used to implement large gear ratios by cascading smaller gear ratios. Okay, so look at here, the relationship between theta 1 and theta 4, all the way theta 4 can be obtained like this. We know that theta 1 over theta 1 is m1 over n2. You just follow it, you know, it is not something, it's not a big deal. Okay, now let us solve this problem. And then maybe have a, no, we can, it is too early. Find the transfer function, okay. The problem is this. Find the transfer function theta 1 of s over t 1 of s, okay. Now, the gears are not ideal. They are not ideal. They have losses due to inertia, due to friction, and they are represented with J and D. Okay, so how can we obtain this? Now, theta 1 over T 1 will be obtained. Okay, so we need to reflect. We need to reflect. Destination is, well, source and destination, they are all, both in the same. Same side on the left hand side. We need to reflect all impedances, okay, all rotational mechanical impedances to the left, okay, to the left, where the output is taken from. Okay, so now, how can we reflect? Okay, let us write J equivalent. At the input, J equivalent on the left. Is there any J here? Yes, there is a J1 on this gear. So J1 plus, J1 plus. And on this level, or at this level, there are two J's, J2 and J3. They are at the same level, J2 plus J3, okay. J2 plus J3 will be reflected by means of this factor. Oops, not M1. N1 over N2. N1 over N2 square. And is there any more J's? Yes, there is one more level. Okay. And in this level, there are two J's. One is J4 and the other one is J5. Plus J4, let me write it because there is no space here, plus J4 plus J5 times, now there are, there's a gear train, right? N1 over N2, okay, times, N3 over N4 square. So this is the equivalent J. Why do not just directly connect A and C? We get the same RPM at C. Well, Hocam, there could be several reasons, okay? Maybe you should ask this to a mechanical engineer, but one answer could be, suppose that I want to have the same direction in the rotation. This is clockwise, this is counterclockwise, this is again clockwise, A and C in the same direction. Maybe because of this. Maybe, I don't know, some motion may be required to be transferred from this side. There may be some reasons. But you are right. Okay, so we are now reflecting the frictions, the equivalent, right? The equivalent. Do we have the yes, d1 plus here there is only one d, right? I can see only one d1 plus d2 and 1 over n2 square. There is no k at all. So the transfer function required was the mechanical sum of mechanical impedances J E S square plus D E S. There is no k, so close the parentheses, times theta 1 of S, theta 1 of S equals T 1 of S. Okay. Oops. This is the answer. Okay. So the theta 1 of S over T 1 of S, okay, equals this 1 over J E S square plus D E S. Okay, as presented here. Okay. There's a numerical example here. Okay. Very easy. I don't want to spend time. Please, you can easily find this result. Okay. Good. Electromechanical system transfer functions. Electric motors are, in fact, really important. They changed our lives tremendously. Even we are today talking about electric cars, all electric cars. You know those Teslas. You know Tall. You know our national electric car. Now they are so popular, right? Electric, even the cars are becoming electric. In fact, at the beginning, the cars were all electric. Somehow they changed. You can find out the reasons, or maybe you know the reasons better than I do. But now, we are going back and saying, oh, things should be electrical now, including the cars. We don't want those IC cars, internal combustion motors, because of those environmental concerns, etc. But as I said, starting from the motion, the cars, every electric motors are now everywhere. We need to use electric motors very effectively. How can we control, how can we use, and how can we control electric motors effectively? We have to know their dynamic behavior very well so that we can design and implement controllers for them. Okay, so in this lecture, the most commonly used motor type, which is a servo motor, armature controlled servo motor, and you accurately control the speed and torque of these kinds of motor. That's why they are called servo motor. How can we obtain their transfer functions? Because in the end, we want to have their transfer function so that we can estimate, or we can know the output to the input we introduce. So look at here. If this is motor, okay, and has a transfer function of G of S, We will introduce electric energy and let us measure it with E for voltage. We are not using V for voltage because V is now for velocity. Okay, so E, as the textbook suggests, I put an A as well, because I apply the voltage from the armature. So A is for armature. So we apply voltage, okay, and suppose that it is already converted to the S domain, or you can write it in this way, okay, and get if some so nice, we are introducing electric variables and getting mechanical variables, theta, motors, displacement, okay, motors, displacement, or motors, speeds, okay. Well, in Turkish and in English, we say motors speed, but in fact, shaft or output shaft of the motors speed, okay? So omega n. How can we relate? By the way, what do we say? Just think inversely. Suppose that we got another transfer function. If this transfer function relates the mechanical variable to electric variable. Okay. This is called motor. Okay, electric motor. And this is called what? Any guess? You are introducing mechanical variable. For example, you are introducing some torque causing some displacement, and you get electric energy. What is this called? Generator, right? Generator. That's why in English we call both of them are called electric machines. I gave this electric machine course at Bilgi University a couple of years ago. Although I don't teach electrical machines, but I love them, to be honest. Electric machines, if we introduce electric energy and getting mechanical output, this is motor. But the other way around, if we introduce mechanical input, rotating the shaft at the input, and you get at the output electrical energy, it's called generator, because it generates electricity, right? Okay, so the aim is, we are not interested in generators, okay? So we are not interested in this. We are trying to establish this relationship. Theta motors displacement, theta m of s over e a of s, or omega m of s over e a of s. Okay, we want to obtain transfer functions relating the output as mechanical variables, either displacement or speed or torque, whatever. But the input is definitely electrical. Okay. This is an DC servo motor. This is the rotational part. You are applying some fixed field. Fixed field is obtained either from permanent magnets. Permanent magnets are readily available in the nature, okay? China and Argentina, I think. They are, but China particularly, they are very rich with those permanent magnets. I don't know, nickel, cadmium, or I was interested in those magnets in the past when we were designing Turkey's largest wind turbine. So we were designing a generator. It is a generator. The input is mechanical. What is wind turbine? The input is the wind itself, and mechanical because the wind forces those wings or pulse to rotate, and when you provide rotation at the input, you get electricity at the output. Okay, so we need to find some field, electromagnetic field, fixed field, either from natural magnets or electrical magnets. Okay, somehow you need to obtain fixed field. So you are giving fixed field, and there is no physical connection between this stationary part and rotational part. Okay, there's an inducement here, or induction, let's say. So fixed field creates two things here. One, rotation, and also this conductor, it is actually a very long, to have a very long conductor, they are wound on some core, okay? I don't want to talk about electric motors, we are in control, but you should get an idea, and maybe this that colleague I sent, I advised him, Professor Alparslan Parlakçı, to invite that young guy. I'm sure maybe you took that course already. So here there is a rotation, and you apply voltage and apply this fixed field, and get a rotation here, and this is the total reactance of the armature RA. This is the total inductance, or equivalent inductance of armature or rotor. In English also, it is called armature, rotor, because it's rotates. There is also a French word, enduit. In Turkish, in the industry, they say enduit. It's coming from French. So this is rotating, right? And there is a back electromotive force is also measured here in terms of voltage, and which is directly proportional to the rotational speed, and you get torque and displacement from the rotor. Okay, and this force, which was felt here by the conductor, can be measured with B, which is the strength of electromagnetic field, L, the length of conductor, and what is this? This is IA. Okay, F equals B L IA. Okay, B L B times L times IA. IA is the current flowing in the armature circuit. Okay, so this is just something general background. Okay, forget about it. But this back electromotive force, okay, this back electromotive force is directly proportional to this speed of rotation. Can we write loop equation? Okay, loop. I promise I'll make this little bit complicated subject very easy, even enjoyable. You will see. Loop equation, okay? Loop equation of this armature circuit, okay? Armature circuit. Look at here. Shall I work in the, okay, let us work in the time domain first, the natural domain. Okay, the voltage applied, okay, the voltage applied will be distributed or will be dropped at each or on each in impedances, right? RA times IA, right? Plus LA times D IA over DT plus VBT, okay, VB of T. Well, IA of T, R IA of T anyway, but I just sometimes drop those time functions. If you take, as usual, we like to work in the S domain. If you take the Laplace transform of this equation, you get EA of S equals RA plus D over DT is S, LA times S IA, IA of S plus VB of S. Okay. Now, what am I trying to obtain? I'm trying to establish this transfer function, theta MS to EA of S. EA of S, the left-hand side is okay. So in the right-hand, on the right-hand side, I want to see theta M. Okay, let us carry on. Messages are keep coming. RA plus LA S times, this is a very well-known fact. The current and torque, they are directly related to each other. There is just a proportionality of torque constant. Constant, okay? So instead of writing IA, you can write the torque, Tm of S over Kt. Kt is just a constant, proportionality constant, okay? Plus Vb of S, what did I say? That Vb of S is something, some voltage, okay, which is directly proportional to the speed of this rotor or armature or NDV, whatever you name it. Okay, VB, B comes from back, the word back, back electromotive force. Okay, so let me write it here. Okay, let me change color. V back electromotive force, VB of T, back electromotive force. Okay. Is in fact, there is a proportionality of constant KB times the speed. What is speed? D theta over DT. You obtain speed, right? Okay, good, good. So you can write here KB times S times theta M of S. Good. We have the left-hand side was good. The right-hand side has two main components. One of them is done. It has a theta M of S. But here, I want to get rid of this TM of S and write it in terms of theta M of S. Okay, how can I do that? So easy, because torque is mechanical variable, theta is mechanical variable. Look at this typical motor loading, okay? Typical motor loading, which has think of this. Think of the motor's shaft. It has a JM, okay? It has, how do you say, a spring constant, torsional and also a friction, right? So the sum of impedances was Jm plus Dm. Oh, excuse me. Jm s square plus Dm s plus Km. Okay. If the shaft is so short, you can ignore Km, but let us keep it. Times theta m of s equals Tm of s. Okay. So look at here. We can get rid of Tm of s, or we can express, we can state Tm of s in terms of theta of s. Theta m of s. Okay, are we doing okay? Yes, you get here. As I said, this k can be ignored because suppose that shaft is too short at the just output of the motor. Shaft is so short, so the torsional loss can be ignored. So I'll write this equation one more time in a better format, in a more desirable format. A of s equals Ra plus Las times Jm s square plus Dm s, okay, times theta m of s over kt, right, over kt, okay, plus kb s theta m of s. Okay, now we can write this transfer function, a long one, theta m of s over ea of s, okay, equals please help me to write it correctly. Ra plus Las times Jm s square plus Dm. Okay. So over Kt. Okay. But let us do this. Plus KT times KB, KT, KB, and K over KT, and it will come to here, KT, KT, KB, S, isn't it? I think this is it, really. I don't want to follow the book's way. I created a slide for that. Let me see. Here it is. Not bad. Kt over Jm s square plus Dms. Ra plus Las plus Kt Kbs. Okay. You can write this transfer function in this form as well. What do you do here? You just, this is important. Let us derive some conclusions from here. Very nice finding. This is very nice finding, believe me. I'll give a break. Don't worry. So this is the transfer function, and it can be also written as theta n of s over ea of s. Okay. Why are we writing this transfer function in different forms? You will see. Kt, I want to take this s out. Why? Because multiplying by s or dividing by s is useful. You are taking derivative of integral. So in s parentheses, right? Jm s plus dm times, let us write in this same form, la, okay, la s plus ra, okay, plus kt kb. Very nice, very nice. Now the question, can you write another transfer function for the speed, omega m of s over dA of s? Do you have to obtain another sets of, you know, equations? No. How can we write that? So simple, I don't need to wait. If you multiply theta m of s by s, in other words, in better words, if you take the derivative of the displacement, angular displacement, you get the angular speed. So take the derivative. Taking derivative means multiplying it by s. So multiply left-hand side by s and right-hand side by s. If you do this multiplication, s times theta m of s gives us omega m of s. And the right-hand side becomes kt over everything, but without this s, okay? So jm s plus dm times, very similar, look, they are mechanical, jm s dm. They are electrical, LAS plus RA. They are so, you know, nicely, in a very convenient form, plus KT, KB. Okay. Yes. Yes. Yes, dear professor. One more thing before I... No, let us take a break. Why am I forcing you? We got 3 minutes to 11. 10 past is okay? Okay. Almost 15 minutes. Okay, now let us pause it. Stop share and where is recording? Pause. Great. It is recording now, right? Good. Now share. Okay. So this is it. I need to zoom in, I guess. This view is here. Zoom in. There's somewhere so that I can enter percentage, but I can't find it. Anyway, let us just zoom in with this. Zoom in. Yes, that's enough. Now, this is the transfer function. Output rotation to input voltage, kt, which is just a constant, proportionality constant for torque. T is for torque, okay? Jms squared plus dms, ra plus las, plus KT. You don't have to memorize, but it is easy to keep it in mind because the form is good. And this is, if you just take S out, you get this expression, okay? And by deleting this S, you get, I want to say, let me write it here. If Oops, what happened? If I do undo this, it makes this city problem. Okay. If this is the typical format, theta m of s over ea of s, okay, is in fact a constant, okay, over s times s plus a. It is in this format, okay? And the speed voltage relationship is this. K over just s plus a. Look, let me show you how practical they are. How do they make sense? Okay, I'm just creating examples now. I just thought of it right now. Now, suppose that I'll give maybe illogical numbers, but let's think that this is let us normalize it. One, and A is also one. Okay, so theta m of s over ea of s is 1 over s times s plus a, all right? S times s plus a. Suppose that we apply 1 volts. Everything is 1, okay? 1 volts. And this is, so ea of s, ea of s is 1 over s in s domain, right? Step function. Suppose that you are applying 1 volts constantly. Okay, so theta m of s over ea of s, in fact, 1 over s square times s plus 1. Okay, s plus 1. If you do partial fraction expansion here for this, you will get this. In fact, k1 over s square plus k2 over s plus k3 over s plus 1, okay? And if you take the inverse Laplace transform, right? Here, there's only theta m of s. Theta m of t becomes, I can find k1, but don't worry about it. I think they are 1, 1, 1, I think, but I don't want to spend time on this. Suppose that they are 1, okay? 1, 1, 1, okay? So 1 over s squared. What is 1 over s squared? What is the inverse Laplace transform of 1 over s squared? Just ramp, isn't it? Ramp, t plus constant, just 1, plus exponential minus t, right? Can you, I know you can do it in MATLAB, okay? But let us plot it here. If this is time, and if this is theta m of t. If you, I can use MATLAB as well. I will, in fact, but we are engineering students. We have to think of the output. You know, we have to guess. Look, this is transient part. It'll die out over time, right? This is, and this is just a constant term, right? And T is a ramp function, isn't it? Excuse me. This is, you know, I'm trying to see if there is a comment. Anyway, so the output is going to be something like this. The transients will die out first, and then it will go something like this. Okay. Is it something stable? Yes, because you are introducing a kind of ramp and getting this output. Okay. So What does that mean? As the time flows, you get more rotation, you know, one tour, two tours, or, you know, 2π radian, another 2π radian, another 2π radian. So it go to, you know, an infinite number. As long as you give energy, it'll keep rotating. How about the omega m of s to ea of s transfer function, which was now, k over s plus one, okay? K over s plus one. Sorry, k is also one, okay? K is also one. So this voltage is one over s. So one over s times s plus one. This could be expanded in this form. Okay. So omega a of t becomes k1 and k2 will be found this 1 and minus 1, you will see. You can find easily. So it'll be 1 minus exponential minus t. Okay. And if you want to plot the output, the speed versus time, you get this. You apply one, okay, and you get this. Okay. So what does that mean? You are ordering the motor to rotate at a certain speed, and after the transients die out, it reaches at this steady state level. Okay, and suppose that you are ordering the motor to rotate at 1000 RPM, and it rotates at that speed. So things really make sense. Okay. Any question, any comments? Where are we? Happy? Easy. Okay, good. Let us carry on. Let us take this, the last finding. Okay. In fact, there is a very usual practice. In fact, they take. I want to get. I'll do this. I'll select one of them. Which one is good? That. Okay. I just wanted to copy it, but I don't know how to copy it. Anyway, there is a usual practice, as I said. They take LA, okay? LA, here it is. LA is usually taken zero because the value of this impedance compared to value of real reactance R, okay, resistor, is so small, so they are usually ignored. So the transfer function becomes KT over, right, JM, which one shall I use? Let us use this one, okay, KT over S times JM, JM RAS, JM RAS plus what else? This term disappears. DMRA, okay, plus DMRA plus KTKB. Oh my God, sorry about this. What shall I do? Let me do this. Let me go to a new page. Now I am known with the tidy professor. I don't want to mess everything up. Okay, look at here now. As you remember, for LA, the inductance is zero. The transfer function theta on of S over EA of S becomes KT over S times, okay, S times, I'll make use of this note, LA, but taking LA zero, okay, JM, JMRAS, okay, plus DMRA, plus DMRA, plus KTKB, okay, KTKB, okay, good. Now, how to evaluate these electrical and mechanical constants. How to find out electrical and mechanical constants. What are they? They are JM, KT, KB, JM, KT, KB, RA. Okay, they are constants. We need to evaluate these. By means of a mathematical operation, okay, I can obtain this transfer function as given in here. Divide each, you know, numerator and denominator by RA and JM. Okay, so KT, why do we do that? It'll be clear. RA, JM, okay, divided by S times, okay, RA, JM, just S, the remaining term is S, plus divide this by RA, okay, RA, JM, okay, what do you get? You get this in 1 over JM parenthesis, okay, JM, okay, JM plus KT, KB, okay, KB over RA. Okay, this is important. Here, there is a so-called dynamometer tests. Dynamometer tests. What are they? They are very commonly used tests. You have a motor, okay? You have a motor, and this is its shaft, okay? There is a mechanism, okay? First, you feed it from here, okay? First, you rotate when there is no load, and omega no load is measured, okay? Omega no load means when there is no load, when There is no load. Or when torque is zero. When there is no torque is taken. Okay. And by means of first give energy, but before it starts rotating, you just hold the shaft standstill. Okay. And measure the torque at that time. Okay. It is called T-stall. T-stall. Measured when the rotation is zero. These are good. By means of these experiments, you specify the constants. Look at me now. Let's go back to this loop equation. You remember this loop equation? We applied voltage, okay, and that voltage was distributed on or dropped on RA. Why there's parenthesis here? RA, IA, plus, if you remember, LA, DIA over DT, but this term is zero, okay? Plus, what? VBT, VB of T, back electromotive force. But this was written as RA, IA of T plus KB times D, D omega of T over DT. This was the, how do you say? This was the equation, loop equation. So what can we do here? Where are what are we doing now? Yeah, well, we are doing okay. I saw my mistake. This was like this KB times D. The speed was this. So here the my mistake is this. There is no derivative, right? Okay, good. So just omega of T. Motors speed, good. So in steady state, this last equation becomes just a linear equation. So there is no T variable as variable. EA becomes RA IA, okay, plus KB. Also, there's one more thing. I don't want to work with the current. Current is for me the torque over KT, if you remember, plus KB omega. Okay. Suppose that you want to obtain these graphics, speed versus torque. So here you can leave. So this is torque of the motor, speed of the motor. Tm, okay, becomes, leave Tm on its own, okay. TN becomes what? Please help me out. KT over RA, you're leaving times KB, okay, omega M. But it is minus, right? Plus KT over RA EA. I think I'm good. Good. Look at here. Isn't it like a typical Y equals minus MX plus N? Just a linear equation, isn't it? It's just a linear equation. So it'll be, okay, and the negative slope, it'll be something like this, okay, which is obtained for a particular value of voltage that you are applying. This is very important. Why? Because from here you can find this point, by means of this so-called dynamometer test. Dynamometer test was two things defined. This is called T stall. Why? When omega is zero, this is called omega no load. Okay, omega no load. When there is no torque, when the motor is energized, but no torque is taken. The shaft is just kept at zero RPM. Okay, so from here, okay, we can find, TM becomes T stall for omega M equals zero. So from in this equation, give zero for omega M, TM becomes T stall equals KT over RA EA. From here, KT over RA, KT over RA is T stall, okay, T stall over, okay, EA, okay. Good, from the experiments you can measure this and you know what EA is. You can evaluate KT over RA. And second relationship is omega M is referred to as omega no load, okay, for TM equals zero. So go to this equation, zero equals minus KT KB over RA times omega no load, right? No load, plus KT over RA times EA. Here, KT over RA, KT over RA, they simplify, and omega no load becomes what? Plus 1 over KB times EA. In other words, KB as a constant can be evaluated by EA over omega no load. Excellent. No load. I couldn't write it. Okay. Omega naught log. So to if you go to this equation, you got here, look at here, KT over RM, K2, KT over RA. KT over RA can be found from T stall over EA. And there is also KB here. Okay. And K, so K, KT over RA is T stall, T stall over EA, isn't it? Yes. And KB is EA. KB is EA over, what was it? Omega no not, yes. Omega no load. Good. So electrical constants can be determined by means of that dynamometer test. How about the mechanical constant? What are the mechanical constant? Jm and dm. So easy, we can evaluate evaluation of the mechanical constants which are Jm and dm. This is done by means of this typical loading. Okay, I think it is somewhere. Here it is. Okay. This is a let me save space. This is a typical motor loading. Okay. DC motor driving a rotation mechanical load. The motor has its armature inertia, armature friction, and of course they are so small compared to JL and DL because they are the load variables. Inertia of load, friction of load. Okay, so let us reflect the impedances on the right hand side to the motor side. So Jm, okay, motor's equivalent inertia becomes Ja, there is already a Ja plus JL, number of teeth on the destination shaft over source shaft square. So we are, because we are stemming from here and going this way, N1 over N2 square, and dm is dA. So I don't want to obtain this simple equation one more time. That's it really. You evaluate, let me write it here, let me complete this here. So this has a J A and D A. Okay. It has this coupled gear. Okay. And this is the loads J, and this is the loads friction. Okay. This is N1, this is N2. So equivalent motor's inertia is J A plus JL times N1 over N2 square. You know how to get it. And dm is the same. dm times N1 over N2 square. That's it. Now let us solve a numerical example. That's enough. You've had it enough. Okay, look at here. Suppose that a motor's torque speed curve is obtained, already obtained, for the input voltage of EA equals 100 volts, and the omega no load, this is omega no load, is measured as 50 RPM, not RPM, 50 radian per second, and stall torque is measured 500 Newton meter. Okay. And the problem is this is a motor driving this load. through these coupled gears, okay, with 101,000 numbers of teeth, obtain theta L of S over EA of S. Okay, let us solve this problem. So what was the I can give you the formula, but you need to know where they are coming from. So, and assuming, I should state that, assuming LA is zero. Okay, theta M of S over EA of S was KT over RAJM, if I can remember. I do remember, but when I write and talk, I sometimes get confused. S times S plus 1 over JM, right? DM plus KT, KB over, this is KT, by the way, KT, KB, RA, as far as I remember. Okay, now, can we, and we know that KT over RA was from here, KT over RA was T stall, this is the formula, okay, KT over RAJM, S times S plus 1 over JM, DM, KT, KB, RA. KT over RA was T stall over EA. Okay. T stall over R EA, excuse me. EA. Okay, so what is KT over RA then? T stall. What is the value of T stall? 500. Okay. 500 over EA, the voltage applied, but 100, which makes 5. And let us evaluate KB. Okay, use another color. KB was, if you remember, what was it? Let me make sure the formula. EA over omega no load, yes. EA over omega no load. Okay, what is EA? 100 over omega no load is, we are just reading of the plot, 50. Okay, so it makes just 2. Now, all I need to find is JM and then DM, of course. Okay, what is JM? JM, here it's, let me save time. JM is JA plus JL M1 over L2 square. So JA is 5 plus JL is 700. So how large it is compared to JA, JL, it's 700. This is just 5. 100 over 1,000. 100 over 1,000 makes 1 over 10. So let me write it here to make it more clear. JA, I'll write the numerical values. JA is just 5, okay, plus JL 700 times M1 over N2 square. So these two zeros goes and just 10 square 10, 100, 7 plus 5 makes 12. And DM in the same fashion can be found as 10. Now all you need to do is substitute those values found, theta n of s over EA of s. Now, KT over array. What is KT over array? KT over array 5. 5. Oh, come on. We don't know JM and DM yet. Okay, what is JM? Let us quickly find it here. JM is J. Oh, found. We found. I'm confused. 5 over 12. Okay, 5 over 12. I thought I didn't. You couldn't find it yet. S times. Okay. S plus 1 over JM. 1 over 12. Okay. Times DM 10 plus KT over array, KT over array 5 times KB, and KB is just 2. Done, we are done. So it is 5 over 12. It makes 0.4 something. Okay, let me see the results. Yes, 0.417. 4417 divided by S times S plus 10 plus 10 makes 20. 20 over 12. 10 over 6. 1 point something. 1667. 1667. Okay. Is this the result we are looking for? No. The problem is this. Theta LS. What is theta LS over EAS? So, what is the relationship between theta M and theta L? This is theta M and this is theta L. This what was the relationship between amount of rotation and number of teeth? In other words, is there any direct relationship or inverse relationship? Directly proportional or inversely proportional? The small, I think, right, how do you say, inversely proportional, because the small one rotates more, right? The small one rotates more. So theta m n2 over n1. Is that okay? And what is this? N2 over 1000 over 100 makes 10. Okay. So theta M is just 10 times theta L. Okay. So this is 10. Okay. So take this theta m is just 10 theta l over EAS equals 0.417 times s plus 1667, and this 10 goes here as division. So theta LS over EAS makes 0.0417 over S times S plus 1.667. That's it. Okay, that's the answer. That's the solution. Well, I can ask more. What is omega LS over EAS? Please give me the answer immediately. Are you there? I start writing 0.0417 over s will disappear. That's it. S plus 1667. You just, you know, derivative of displacement gives us the speed. Okay. You can get different speed torque curves for different values, various values of voltage you apply. Look at this is a very similar example. I'm leaving it to you. What is the time? Good, we've got some more minutes, okay. Please ask questions if you have any. No? No questions? Okay. I'm leaving it to you. It's a nice example. Okay. Now, in fact, it is time to start modeling in the time domain, in other words, state-space methods. But there is another section here called electric circuit analogs. This topic was much more important in the past, but it is still important to me. Why? Because I appreciate the uniqueness of mathematical models, okay, representing mechanical stuff, electrical stuff, I don't know, those chemical reactions, etc. Look at here, look at what I am saying, I'm trying to say. What is the equation of motion of this? Equation of motion of this one degree of freedom system, because there's only one mass that can move independently, okay? As you know, I'm not writing, shall I write in the time domain first? No, I won't. I did it in the beginning. So look at here now. Sum of impedances, ns square plus fvs plus k times the linear displacement equals the force applied, okay? Now the problem is electric circuit analogs. Analog means a kind of imitation, or representation, right? Can we represent a mechanical system with an electric system, electric network, electric circuit? Suppose that you are designing a mechanical stuff, mechanical setup, okay, and trying to obtain its equation of motion, trying to do some designs. Working with mechanical variables are not so easy. You cannot change the mass according to your wish. You cannot play with the friction. You cannot play with the elasticity, as much as you wish. But you can do this, you can do these things in electrical circuits. So if you can represent a mechanical system with an electric circuit, it would be easy for you to play with it, to play with the parameters, okay? Look at here now. Can we represent this with an electric circuit? This is the problem, right? If we do this, instead, let us draw an electric circuit here, plus, minus. Suppose that this the voltage is applied here, okay? and this is your resistor, this is the inductor, this is the capacitor, right? Okay. This is the current flows. Okay, so this is R, this is L, this is C. So in S domain, okay, again, sum of impedances R plus LAS plus 1 over Y LA. We are not working with the motor armature. Okay. R plus LS plus 1 over CS times sum of impedances times current, okay, gives us the voltage applied. Now, can you establish an analogy between these two equations? We can take this equation here, okay, do this. Take one of the S out, okay? So M S plus F V plus K over S times S times X of S equals F of S. F of S. Now, this is in fact MS plus FB plus K over S times, what is S times XS? S times XS. S times derivative of displacement, just velocity, isn't it? Now, the relationship between this equation of motion and this loop equation is so obvious. Look at here, MS, mass and mass and inductor are analogs, okay? Resistor and friction. But let me write in the same order, okay? So there's M, mechanical variables are M, F, V, and K, right? So what is the analog of FV? Analog of FV is F is alone R, okay, the resistor in electrical circuits, and K over S, one of K is the same as or analog with 1 over C, not just C. Furthermore, the right hand side of the equations, voltage and the force applied, they are analogs to each other. What else? One more thing. The electricals are here. This is current, isn't it? Current and what? Velocity. They are also analog to each other. So this circuit, okay, this circuit can be represented with this mechanical system can be represented with this circuit by taking E representing force, okay? R representing viscous friction, L representing M, C 1 over K. Okay. You see, we can represent a 1 degree of freedom system with electrical components. Okay. There are some analysis here, you know, as we did it with you. And if there are, if you have 2 degrees of freedom, you represent that mechanical system with a circuit with 2 loops. Okay. Okay. Some examples are coming. I think that's enough. That's enough. So as you see, any system can be represented with electrical circuits and do all those computations in on the circuit. I think I will stop here. This is the end of chapter 2. Okay, so chapter 2, let us summarize it. Chapter 2 was on modeling systems in the complex frequency domain, in the S domain. So we little bit covered or did a recap of Laplace transforms, okay? And then we represented electrical networks in the S domain as transfer function, as transfer functions, which relate the output to the input. And then we covered mechanical systems. First, the linear motion, mechanical systems involving only linear motion, which are called translational mechanical systems. And we obtained transfer functions of some. One of them is still in front of you. 1 degree of freedom, 2 degrees of freedom systems. So we can we could obtain the transfer functions of translational mechanical systems. We are familiar with them. And then we moved on to rotational mechanical systems. Okay, and rotational mechanical systems with gears. So we obtained the mechanical systems, rotational mechanical systems transfer functions as well. And finally, we combined mechanical and electrical systems, which give us the electromotor, the unique or basic component of motion. Okay, they are everywhere. So we obtained a simple transfer function of a DC motor, servo DC motor. I think that's it for this week. Next week, I'll represent things in the time domain, or at least I'll show how to represent systems in the state space as state or with state variables. Okay, my dear students and my dear friends, any questions? There is one question. Good, I'm so happy. I hope the question is not difficult. Thank you. It's my pleasure. Thank you. Okay, I know I didn't go so further. I would be much faster, but I just wanted to enjoy the class and make you enjoying the topics. So it was, I think we did okay. Okay then. Thank you. Herkese iyi günler dilerim. You all have a great day.